got started.
Hey, hey, everybody.
They can't see you, by the way.
Oh, okay. Hi. Welcome to Breakthrough Ministries on this gorgeous, gorgeous Sunday with this beautiful weather that my sister hates. She's ready for the pumpkin spice and the cold, bundling up with the blankets, going on hayride. And I'm the summer lover. Sorry.
Hey, all the seasons coexist.
That's right. Yours is coming.
Mine's coming.
Y'all just bear with us. We're going to get started with some great worship and praising the Lord and hearing the word of the Lord. Sorry about the dogs. Amber's going to chill them out.
It's husband and wife getting in a fight with each other. That's all it is. They're not agreeing. They're kind of like a typical human husband and wife.
Y'all be blessed. Let's get into the worship mode.
You gonna do the announcement?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I'll do the announcements. All right. Breakthrough is more mobile than a mobile phone. If you know a church that wants us to come and minister, have them to get in contact with us so we can set it up. They can message Brother Adam, Amber, me, Tim, Taylor. We're also, they're planning on setting up walls around their carport before winter. I don't think my mic's working. No, it's not. It's acting silly.
Can you?
Oh, Jake, you're on.
Hello. She's on now. There goes the announcement. You should be able to hear them perfectly well now.
We, woo! Hot mic. Yes, we are very mobile. That is what our ministry wants to do. We want to get out. That's why we're outside. We want to be out spreading the word of God, equipping people to deal with the spiritual warfare that's going on in the world, because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against the powers and principalities of this world. If you believe in angels, you have to believe that there's demonic forces at work. And we must stand strong in the word of the Lord. That's what Jesus wants us to do. So if you would like us to come and minister at your church, we would be more than happy. That's what we want to do. So just get in contact with us. Next. Tithes and offerings. If you're here, you can put your offering in the container. We also have the Cash App. If you have the app, just go to $Breakthrough42129 for online giving. Or you can type in cash.app/$Breakthrough42129. If you would like to mail your tithes and offerings, you can mail those to 436 Yellow Hammer Road, Columbia, Kentucky, 42728. Thank you. If you have any prayer requests, please put those in the comments, and we will read those and pray over those. If you don't mind, like our page, like this post, share it. Sorry about the back feed or whatever it's called. If you're on YouTube, please subscribe to our channel and whatever else that you do on
subscribe
YouTube.
Subscribe and then hit the little notification.
Hit the notification button. Ding! All right, I'm going to give you your mic back. Mine's kind of working.
All right, well, let's just get started with the prayer and then go straight into worship. Amen?
Amen.
Lord, we thank you for this wonderful, beautiful day that you've given us, even though my wife thinks it's a little too hot, but it's still a beautiful, wonderful day, and we thank you for that. Lord, you are so great and you are so awesome. We just bow before your presence, knowing that you are with us in everything that we do. And we ask you, Lord, just to encourage us, strengthen us, and help us. And Lord, as we enter into this time of worship, let us worship you, praise you, and honor you in a way that is fitting to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Empty-handed, crying out from the pit of my despair. And there you were in the shadows, holding out your hand. You led me there. And now, where would I be without you? Where would Jesus, you are the voice in the desert, calling out in the dead of night, fighting my vitals for me. You are my rescue story, you lifted me up from the ashes, carried my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You are my rescue story.
Is he your rescue story? Tell us about it. We love to hear testimonies.
Amen.
Stand up with us and worship the Lord.
my breakthrough that God just gave me. Kind of started on me last night, a little bit about it, but really as I was walking up and down the road just now. Because being outside at a carport, you get that luxury. You can walk up and down the road and worship. So, hey, praise be to God for that, right? Mm-hmm. So just real quickly, I'm going to read this. I'm going to share what God showed me. Blessed are the poor in spirit. This is Matthew 5, the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Hallelujah.
Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted.
Yes.
Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth.
Amen.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Mm-hmm. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Yes. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Woo-hoo. Now listen to this one very carefully, because this is my key one. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of God.
Yes.
Now here's the catch that I want to say. Out of all of these, I mean, we're talking about inheriting the earth. We're talking about seeing God. We're talking about obtaining mercy, being filled, all of these things. But only one of them has the distinct honor of being called sons of God. And those are peacemakers.
Yes.
Those are peacemakers. Now, what does it mean to be a peacemaker?
Well, sometimes to make peace, it comes with, you know, violence.
We're not going violent, honey. Snack. But one thing that God showed me as part of the mission just now of Breakthrough, and I think everybody's on board with this, is we're going to hit the controversial topics.
Again.
Right. We're going to hit, especially those in the Bible. We talk about tongues. We talk about spiritual warfare. We're talking about deliverance. All these different topics that a lot of church people will, let's be honest, run from. Right? They're going to run from it. Breakthrough Ministries, part of our goal is to get people that breakthrough so that they can understand that they don't have to run from these things, so that they can be the sons and daughters of God that they are called to be. Because the fact is to be a Christian is not to be a peacekeeper. I've talked about this before. Mm-hmm. Keeping the peace means you're going to run from things. You're going to hide from things. You're going to stay away to do that. But a peacemaker is going to hit those controversial marks. They're going to hit those things. They're going to go to war.
Thank you.
That's what they're going to do.
Yeah, they're going to intervene.
Exactly.
Intervene,
intercede. Mm-hmm. All these different things. So what Breakthrough Ministries, what we're really about, is we want to see you have that breakthrough. We don't call it Breakthrough Ministries just because it sounds good. We call this Breakthrough Ministries is because we want to see people get the breakthroughs. And you cannot have those breakthroughs unless you hit the things that people don't like to talk about. Because there is people walking around, and I'm probably going to get some slack over this, but hallelujah, I don't care. There are people walking around all over this world, common folks, rich people, and even government officials that have got demons.
Yep. Unfortunately, that's true.
It is. It's very true. They got demons. There's this old saying, you got to fight your own demons. You don't have to fight your own demons by yourself. That's why the church is established. We are the bride of Christ. And that's part of what, another part of what Breakthrough Ministries is to show people what really that means to be the bride of Christ. Because when you are Christ's bride, when you are Christ's wife, then you know what happens? You're going to set other people free. You're going to see other people get free to come into the fold. So we may not be your traditional looking church. We may never look like any type of traditional thing. But I promise you that there's one goal we have in mind. It's for you to be a son or daughter of the Most High God. And for that to happen, we have to be sons and daughters of the Most High God.
Yes.
Which means we have to be peacemakers. And we want you to be a peacemaker as well. I think the next song is Our God.
Yep.
Yes, sir.
Matthew 11:4-6.
I thought I would get him. Nice try.
I know.
Matthew.
That was Mr. Tim Brown hiding behind the television back there.
Yeah, where it says Jesus answered and said to them. Jesus answered and said to them, "Go and tell John the things which you hear and see. The blind see, and the lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who is not offended because of me." The words of Jesus.
Yes. Praise be to God.
Yes. Ties right into it. Ties right into it. Amen, Tim. Amen.
Yes.
The wise
Jesus.
So here's the thing. This song they're getting ready to do, it's Our God, right?
Our God, yeah.
There's a part in it that quotes Romans 8:31. If our God is for us, who can be against us? He is our God. I claim ownership of him because he claims ownership of me. So with that said, exactly. With that said, listen to this song and ask yourself, are you truly claiming ownership of God right now? Because he wants you to. He wants to call you his son. He wants to call you his daughter. But you have to call him Father first.
Amen.
So there you go.
Into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, no, none like you.
Jesus.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Thank you.
do me a favor and make sure that I am somewhat with lined up the way I need to be. Praise God.
Ow.
I can't even see.
Cassandra, can you help her to make sure we got that lined up right? Because apparently she can't see it.
Yes, it looks good.
All right. Praise God. So, last week we started off with a message, why is deliverance for today? And we're going to kind of continue in that same pathway. But before we get into that, God's doing some downloading and some stuff for me today. Praise God for it. But when I first started in the ministry, as I look back, I was being groomed to be an ordained elder in the Methodist Church. Now, understand, I have nothing against the Methodist Church. They've been very good to me. I've stepped away from them because that's what God was calling me to do. Part of the reason He was calling me to do it is because I'm the type of person that I'm going to read the Bible, and I'm not just going to go with what other people tell me it says. I'm going to read into it. I'm going to try to figure it out. I'm going to try to break down what's being said so that I can find the real truth of Jesus. Amen? So in the midst of that, and in me being groomed for whatever the Methodist Church was grooming me for, they did a really good job, except for one thing. They really taught me how to really get into the Word. They really taught me how to see what's really happening. They really taught me to understand that the church today is not operating at the level that it needs to operate. And that's why we had the sermon last week talking about that deliverance is for today. And that's why we're going to have the topic, the same particular sermon in a different way, talking about how to prepare for it. But let's look at these things again. Let's look at Matthew 10:5, which kind of goes along with the scripture that Tim was talking about in a different way. It says this: these 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, do not go into the way of the Gentiles, and do not enter the city of the Samaritans, but rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Okay? Because that's before the Gentiles were able to get. So this is now for everyone as we go continue through. And as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out the demons. Freely you have received, freely you get, freely give. You know what is honestly the most controversial out of that whole thing? It's not casting out demons. It's not even raising the dead. Freely give. That's probably the most controversial thing out of the whole thing. And I'm not trying to get into that right now, but this is just something God's just shown me. Praise God. He's just downloading things. People are all about freely receiving, getting the gifts. But when it comes to giving it to others, well, they're just going to squander it away. Well, they're going to waste it. Yeah, or they're going to complain because it's broken. They're not going to complain because it's not good enough. It's not our job to deal with those things. It just says, freely you have received, freely give. And one of the things that we give that this is talking about is, if you look at this as a holistic thing, we as the church are called to give healing to people through Jesus. We as the church are called to preach the kingdom of heaven, to give the gospel to people. We as the church are called to give cleanliness, whatever you want to call it, to lepers. We as the church are called to give life to those who are dead. We as the church are called to deliver those who have demons. We're called to do those things. So much call to do then. So see, what the Methodist Church did is they taught me how to walk in the supernatural level of God. And I'm still not fully there, but I'm getting there more and more every day. Amen?
Amen.
So today, like I said, we're going to talk about being prepared to do deliverance. Okay? We're going to talk about how you get yourself ready to see someone delivered, to pray over them, to cast those demons out. Because it is very important to understand that, understand this preparation, because in Acts 19, you can look it up for yourself. There's too much scripture in that to really put it in today. But you can look and see where these Jewish exodus were so enthused by what Paul was doing by casting out these demons that they tried to do it even though they didn't claim Jesus. Therefore, whenever they tried to do it, what happened? They got beat up. They got hurt pretty bad by the demon because they were not prepared. So first and foremost, what does this tell us about preparation for deliverance? You got to be saved if you're going to deliver someone. You got to be saved. You got to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Now listen to this statement because this is very important. No non-Christian can deliver someone without being open to the spirits attaching to them. Because when you go into battle against demons, it is a spiritual warfare. And if you are not prepared, if you do not have the blood of Jesus covering you, this is the first and foremost and the greatest part of preparation. If you do not have the blood of Jesus, then they can hit you and they can hit you hard. I have some great proof of that. When I was starting to learn about deliverance and starting to learn how all this plays out, the Lord had me watch a show. It's not a Christian show, but it's a show nonetheless, called Ghost Hunters. He had me watch it for a season to learn the what to do's and the what not to do's in deliverance. And one of the things that I noticed very quickly in that show, or no, it's not Ghost Hunters, it's Ghost Adventurers, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes, sorry, my bad. I was on the wrong show.
I know what you're talking about.
Yes, but I want to make sure that I say the right show in there. So it's Ghost Adventurers. But one of the things I first noticed is whenever Zach and his crew would go into these haunted places and all these different things, they were getting attacked like crazy. Fall marks and all these different things, but more than that, yeah, they would talk about for days on end afterwards how that they would feel what had happened to them while they were there. They'd still feel the heaviness and all these other things. Why is that? I'm not saying anything about their salvation. I don't know, but I do know that there was an open door in their life that it was allowing that to happen. I learned a lot on that show. And this is why preparation is something, and I'm reading some of this just straight off of what I got. And this is why preparation is something that we have to do for deliverance. And to be honest, you can't just get yourself prepared a few hours before, a few minutes before. The Word tells us to always be ready in season and out of season. So we always have to be prepared. Therefore, everything that we talk about on how to be prepared to do deliverance is really inevitably just an everyday life thing in and of itself, because we always need to be ready. So we can apply this in two ways. We can apply it to being ready in the sense of casting out demons and seeing people delivered from the evil spirits and all these things that are affecting so many people. But we can also look at it as a way of how we are always getting ourselves ready for what God has in store for us next.
Amen.
So first and foremost, Ephesians 6:13 will be the next one up there. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. Now listen to how this says. You notice that there is, go back one, Tim. Go forward one. I must have left.
13's right
there. 13's right there?
13's right down the corner.
Okay. I must have left this one on here, so I do apologize.
That's funny, I started out speaking that first one.
Yeah.
Didn't even know you was going to have this in there.
But here's the word I want to focus on. Take up the whole armor of God. It doesn't say part. It doesn't say some. It doesn't say whatever piece you want to pick up today. It says take up the whole armor of God. Now, I'm not going to get into the belt and the breastplate and the shield and all of those things. Those things have been preached through and through and through. And everybody that has preached them has pretty much been on point with them. Because they are the armor of God. The only problem is when you preach about the armor of God, when you hear these sermons, everybody stops at verse 17. And verse 17 is talking about the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. Everybody talks about that part. That part is powerful and that's great. That's the rhema word. That's the word that's used there, rhema. That means it's the things that come out of your mouth. You're using your mouth as an instrument. Your mouth is the sword. But being that said, perfect time for a pause. Thank you, Jesus. Verse 17 is where most people stop. Let's look at 18, 19, and 20 and see what they say. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful for this end with all perseverance and supplication for all saints, and for me that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mysteries of the gospel. Notice what that says, to make known the mysteries of the gospel. If we're going to fight the devil, we got to know the mysteries of God. Amen? For which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. This starts off, and it continues in. I mean, you look at this and you see that we are not done with the armor of God. It says, praying always with prayer and supplication in the Spirit, that in and of itself is praying in tongues.
Yes.
Some people will say, well, I don't have to pray in tongues to pray in the Spirit because He just gives me the English words. No, that you're wrong. I'm sorry. I've done too much study on this. You're wrong. And I'm not trying to be mean right now, but I'm just being true and I'm being real with you. And I want to explain this out right now. Praying in tongues is a key. Because we can pray the most elaborate, beautiful, powerful prayer in our known language and still not pray what we need to pray. Because when we're praying in our own language, we're thinking of what to say. All this is happening. When you pray in tongues, the reason it says pray in the Spirit is because you pray, when you pray in tongues, Holy Spirit comes along and joins with your spirit, joins with my spirit, and that prayer is exactly what is needed for that exact time. Mm-hmm. A few months ago, I started on my way to work. I started praying. I've told everybody that I do this thankful prayer. But before I even started the thankful prayer, I will pray in the Spirit on the way to work. And I've got about a 20-minute drive to work, so I can do both and have plenty of time to get things done. But it was very interesting to me that when I started doing this, praying in the Spirit every day, and I want to tell you, some days it's not easy to do. Some days I have to force myself to do it. And some people say, well, that's exactly why it's not of God. I said, no, that's not. Don't forget, we're battling against in a spiritual warfare, And the devil wants to stop you from doing anything that's going to cause you to grow. So if I'm having to battle to do something, that I'm seeing results, that every time that I have prayed in the Spirit, every day that I do that, my days at work have gotten so much better. I don't have as much conflict in and of myself. I don't have as many problems. I don't battle my own self as much because when I'm doing this, that peace goes along with me all day. I find the exact things that I need to say each and every day to do my job because I'm praying in the Spirit. In the days that I may forget to do it, you know what happens? Or the days that I don't do it? Those are my worst days. So you tell me that me struggling to do it is not is saying that it's not real or it's not helpful. Well, I just explained to you that it is. In my own personal endeavor, in my own personal walk. Because when I'm praying in the Spirit, just like what Romans 8 tells us, I am joining in with the Holy Spirit and we are praying together for the will of the Father to be done in so many different circumstances. And I could be praying for somebody in China when I'm doing it. And if I'm doing that, praise God that I'm doing it. Praise God. Because I have learned that when I pray in the Spirit, when I pray in tongues, things get more accomplished than they do when I pray in English. Because I'm praying with the Holy Spirit. So why is that important to preparation for deliverance? Very simple. I think I just explained it. Without even using deliverance, it gets your mindset right. It gets you connected with Holy Spirit. It gets you in a place to where you can flow through the will of God. So that when the demons come up, they can say, I know him. I know her. Because you're already connected. Now understand when I say this. There is a difference between praying in tongues and speaking in tongues. And that's a different sermon for a different day. But just understand for now, you can read 1 Corinthians 14 and you will find a particular passage in there where it talks about that. But for now, we're good. The second thing that Ephesians 6:18 tells us, it says to be watchful. To be watchful. The thing is you never know when somebody's going to be needed to be delivered from something because you never know when a demon might manifest. Just think about it this way. Have you ever seen somebody, maybe you know them, and you know that they can get angry at times. But every once in a while, there's just like this deep embedded anger that just rolls out of them. It's like, where did that come from? I know they're an angry person to begin with, but this is a whole other level. Demon could have manifested just then. Be watchful. I love in the movie War Room, and I wish we could all be this bold, and I want to get there. That in that movie, when that little lady and the woman are walking in a parking garage or whatever it is, and this robber comes up and got a gun pointed at them and says, give me all your stuff. She just says, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke you or leave or what. I don't remember how she does it, but she just says, in the name of Jesus. Next thing you know, the dude's gone and everybody else is all in a whirlwind. The police are there and the woman's a little old lady sitting there eating ice cream like nothing happened. And she's explaining to them what happened and they're just bum-puzzled on how that happened. There's a truth to that matter. There's a truth to that. She's watchful. She was watchful. Ever watching what is going on. And when you're ever watchful, I don't mean being watching just with your physical eyes. I mean watch with your spirit, man. Watch what it's saying. Listen. When you get that unction that something needs to happen, go with it. And Emily, if you're watching, Auction, I said that just for you.
Let me have a drink of that, bud.
Another part is it talks about being watchful with each other. Being prepared to do deliverance is just like being prepared to be a Christian. We got to have each other. We need each other. There's a reason why the second greatest commandment is love your neighbor as yourself. Because we need each other. We can't do this alone. Finally, it talks about being bold. If you are not bold when doing deliverance, if you're not bold, you might as well go home and sit down and don't even worry about it. Because if you're not bold, you're given a stronghold to the enemies, the enemy, the spirits and or demons to take over in you. But this is a special boldness. It's not the boldness we see of the world. This is a Jesus boldness. Okay? It's best described in this next verse, 2 Timothy 1:7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. What's one of the greatest ways to stop being bold? And that's to be fearful. Fear is a hot topic. If there's a controversial topic right now, fear is probably one of the greatest controversial topics out there because people are so concerned, fearful, of what's going to happen. They're afraid of this and they're afraid of that. But for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. To be prepared for deliverance, you cannot be afraid, concerned, or any other word you want to use to fill in the blank for that means. If you are afraid, then you need to step away. Because once again, all that's doing is giving an open door for the enemy to attack you. And you're not going to get anybody delivered because the demons are going to be stronger than you because they have that fear on their side. I put this in here, I've underlined it because this statement is so powerful. If you are fearful, then you are allowing the darkness to have a part in you. Therefore, that spirit of fear will give the spirit and or demon the strength they need to resist anything and everything you say or do. Why? Because fear is not of God. Fear is of the devil. And I hate to break it to you, but the devil's kingdom is not a divided kingdom. It's not. The devil's kingdom is unified in trying to take down God. Yes, please.
We need to be unified.
Yes, we have to be just as unified in that. Once fear is gone, now listen to this. So once you get that spirit of fear out, I'm trying to see if I can deal with this. There we go. Once you get that spirit of fear out, then instead of having the demons try to come in, you're having an open door for power and love and a sound mind, which is where boldness comes from that we need, is that. See, a sound mind is key. When you look at this, because who's the author of confusion?
The devil.
The devil. And if you have a sound mind, guess what? You're not confused. The power of God is what we need because when we have God's power, we have God. And when God is for us, who can be against us? And yes, that was wrote down before we did all the songs and stuff. And then love is the greatest key to this boldness, okay? Love is the greatest key. And when I talk about love, I don't mean loving someone and being a peacekeeper. I mean loving someone enough to be a peacemaker in their life.
Yeah.
Loving them enough to tell them that what they're doing is wrong.
That's right.
Loving them enough to tell them that, yes, you are judging them with righteous judgment. Because here's a loop for a lot of people. The Bible says, judge not, lest you be judged. Do not judge according to appearance, but judge according to righteous judgment. So the Bible never really tells us not to judge, but it tells us to be careful how we judge. Yes. So this whole thing of don't judge me, bro, is not real in the Bible.
Right.
We're called to judge people by righteousness. Mm-hmm. So when we're called to judge people by righteousness, that's why the Bible says that if we claim to have Jesus, we must walk as Jesus walked. If we have the Holy Spirit, then we must walk with the Holy Spirit. The reason being is if we are going to see people free, if we're going to see people delivered from the things that's going in their life, we have to love them enough to step into their life and say, hey, what you're doing right now is wrong. This is not a lifestyle that is deemed holy in the Bible. This is not a lifestyle that is deemed righteous in the Bible. This act is not an act that is found godly in the Bible. This act is an act that is found sinful in the Bible. And by those standards, we have to step into that place and see. And so many people have got into this or that and all these other things, saying, well, you look at it this way and you look at it that way. That's not really the truth. That's not really the truth. Oh, Lord, help me. A great example of that is the word homosexuality in the Bible. Understand that word. I will agree with the crazies out there. I will agree that word was not in the original English language, or not in the original Bible, because the word homosexual had not become a word at that point in time, and that's the reason why it wasn't. But the word that is used is a word to describe the homosexual action of male on male. Now, some people will say, well, that word that is used, it says it's talking about a boy. Let me clear that up. Sandra, I'm probably about to make a lot of people mad. We may just get this one banned from Facebook. Amen?
Amen.
Here's the truth of the matter. That word, it doesn't mean man and it doesn't mean boy. It means male. So it actually means man and boy, which puts pedophilia and homosexuality in the same boat. I hate it for those people that have been misled by this. But if I don't speak the truth to you about... If I don't speak the truth to you about this, then I need to put down this mic and go away, and I don't need to be here. Because I need to speak the truth so that you can have the freedom that you need from all of these things that are going on. Because this world has got into a place that we're not prepared to deliver people, because we are too open to everything and anything and saying that whatever happens goes and all this other stuff. Like Lady Gaga's song, I was born this way. So what if you were? You got to be born again to be a Christian. You got to be born again to follow Jesus. Give me that argument you were born this way. I'm going to tell you right now. Read John chapter 3. Jesus tells you to be born again. He tells you that you've got to be born of water and spirit. Born of flesh and spirit. A lot of people say that born of water means to be baptized. No, it doesn't. That born of water is a fleshly birth. What's the first thing that happens to a woman when she starts to go into labor?
Her water breaks.
Huh! Born of water. There's some spiritual water that's about to be broken in some people's lives, because there's some labor pains coming, because the Holy Spirit's about to invade some people in a way that they've never experienced.
Amen.
A thing is about to happen that there is going to become a new birth in the church, that it's not just going to be about breakthrough ministries or any other one particular church, but God is having labor pains right now because people are rising up and saying, we want more of God and we want to see the devil defeated. And people are starting to understand and realize what I'm trying to preach to you today and tell you about today, because people are seeing the reality that all this mess that's been going on for the last 20 or 30 years is just that. It's a big, hot, stinking mess that God is ready to unleash his saints on to fix it. And to be clear, I'm not just talking about homosexuality. I'm talking about abortion. I'm talking about all this other junk and crap that's going on that the Bible is against. Talking about sex before marriage. Living together and not being married. Every bit of that's a sin in the Bible.
I'm going to get kicked off Facebook.
But you know what? I don't care. For at least the people watching this, I hope you hear what I'm saying. Because I'm not saying this to be mean. I'm really not. This ain't even in my notes. I did not mean to go here today. I'm saying this because I love you. And I'm tired of seeing you fighting a battle of being broken and being hurt and carrying around your past that has burned you for so long. So instead of actually facing it, you've buried it and went into all these other ideologies and all these other things simply to try to fix yourself, when in reality what you need is you need some Jesus to come into you and bring the healing that you need from all that stupidity. And yes, I call it stupidity that happened to you because you never deserved it. It was never meant for you to happen. But the devil used people to break you down, and he's still got a stronghold in you today. And I say you need to be free from that.
Hallelujah. Maybe there's a reason there's not a lot of people here today, simply because I'm probably so loud and deafening some people.
Okay. I'm saying all this because I love you. And I want to see you set free. And Jesus promises us that whoever he sets free is free indeed. And I'm tired of seeing people walk around burdened down about their identity and all these other things. You're not going to find your identity in your gender. You're not going to find your identity in your sexual orientation. You're not going to find your identity in your political party. You're not going to find your identity in your job. You're not going to find your identity in what all you have. Or you're not going to find your identity in how much money you have. You can be the biggest millionaire in the world and still have no clue who you are. You're not going to find your identity in making people laugh and doing all these other things. I use the example of, who was that actor that just recently committed suicide?
Robin Williams.
The man can make anybody laugh. The dude was a master comedian. A master comedian. But yet apparently he was so depressed and had so much burning him down that he took his own life, you guys. I don't want to see that happen to you. And yes, I'm pointing at the cameras right now. I don't want to see that happen to you. I want to see you free. I want to see you free. Hallelujah. I may have to change this, do the rest of this next week. I don't even know where I'm at. Praise God. A love that is so strong that it does not care about offending, because it is more focused on freedom, hope, and faith. I'm going to say that one more time. The love that we need, the love that second that this verse is talking about, a spirit of love. Because listen to what this says. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit, to see it's of, but of, so a spirit, but a spirit of power, and a spirit of love, and a spirit of sound mind. So this spirit of love that we are speaking about here is one that really doesn't care if it offends you or not. Because when you're a peacemaker,
And when you really love someone this deeply and you care about them this much, you're going to offend them. Because you're going to call them out. And they might get mad and they may not talk to you for a long time. They may never talk to you again. And you know what? That's the cost of it. But I would rather have them never talk to me again and find the freedom that Jesus wants for them because of that one instance than them being bound the rest of their life because I kept my mouth shut. Amen? I'm tired of keeping my mouth shut. I'm tired of it. It's boiling in me. Just like Jeremiah, that fire is burning in me so hot that there's sometimes I don't want to say it, but I just can't help. I can't help but just let that fire come out. I got so wrapped up in that I missed the whole power part. But I think it pretty well covered it with the love. Amen. But there is a spirit of power that's mentioned here. Acts 1:8 says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And what is that power used for? To be witnesses. What do witnesses do? One of the things witnesses do is deliver people from the evil and the forces of darkness. Part of the things that witnesses do is see people be free. It's one of the things they do. All right. That one's free. Amen. Let's get back on track here. Hallelujah. I don't know if I'm hot because it's hot outside or I'm hot because God's got me fired up. I think it's a mixture of both. Amen. Amen. Last verse to wrap this up. Mark 9:22. I'm about to skip an explanation before I even get started on the verse. Mark 9:22 and 23 says this. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. The enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. So the final two things to be prepared for deliverance is this. Belief and righteousness. Why do I say righteousness when I mention this? You got to understand the context of Mark 9:22. Right before this happens, Jesus is up on the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus is being encouraged by Moses and Elijah. Moses by the law, and Elijah by the prophets. He was being filled with the presence of the Father. And just as a side note, this particular passage, and as soon as Jesus comes out of everything that he dealt with his 40-day fast in the wilderness and being attacked by the devil, these are the two times we find Jesus being ministered to. All these just individual faith people, I'm about to blow them out of the water. See? Blow them out of the water. If Jesus himself needed encouragement from others, if Jesus himself needed to be ministered to, what makes you think you don't?
Amen.
I know I need it. There's no doubt in my mind I need it. I need somebody to help me. Why did he need it? Because walking the Christian walk, it ain't easy. it's the most blessed thing you'll ever do in your life, but it ain't easy. It can be hard. Why? Because the devil's going to throw everything out at you. That's why this preparation for deliverance is ultimately a way of life. So righteousness. Jesus has been in a place of up there being ministered to, being encouraged, whatever you want to say. He's been up there, that being done by the saints of old, if you will, in that with Moses and Elijah. He's being ministered to by the law and the prophets. And as he is coming down off the mountain, he encounters a man who has a son, a man whose son is being beat up by demons. And they're trying to destroy him. A man, a boy that today, if he was going on with this, we would call him to probably have epileptic seizures. Would that be about right?
Mm-hmm. Or he'd be in a psych ward.
Or he'd be in a psych ward, yeah. This man comes to the disciples. Disciples can't do it. And he comes to Jesus. And he says to Jesus, and this is where all this comes in, and this is where righteousness comes into this place, because when you have the righteousness, you have the love. When you have the love, you have the power. When you have the power, when you have the love, you have the faith. When you have the faith, you have the power. And when you have the power, you have the authority. Amen? So Jesus had come down in this righteous place and encountered evil. Yeah, when you get into that place where you're in the presence of God, don't think when you walk out the door, the devil's not waiting for you. He's waiting for you. And he's going to mess with you. But listen to what Jesus says, because this is where belief comes into play. This man asked Jesus, if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. This man asked a particular question. A question that starts with the big word, if. Just like fear. If you've got a spirit of fear, you need to walk away from doing a deliverance, because it ain't going to happen. Right. And if it does happen, their life will get attached to you, and it's just going to be a hot mess for you. Even more so, if you have the question if going on in your head, that means you have a doubtful spirit going on with you, and you need to walk away as well. God created the heavens and the earth. Throughout history, even Old Testament and New Testament, he has done signs and wonders like crazy. Why would you doubt him? I will tell you why you will doubt him. Because you have been trained, especially here in the United States and in Western civilization. I'll go beyond the United States. I'll include Europe as well. You have been trained. And I almost want to say brainwashed, but I really don't want to use that. But I guess I will. To believe that you have to do things a certain way. And that certain way does not include God doing signs and wonders. Because all he's there for is just to get you to heaven. Even the modern church today, that is what they have been preach to. That's why 90% of your sermons heard in Western civilization is either about being happy-go-lucky or getting saved. Amen?
Amen.
I don't need to preach salvation to a bunch of saved people. I need to get some meat on their bones. They need to believe something more. Because let's just be honest about this guy. This guy that Jesus came up and made this if statement, he believed Jesus. Because he said, I believe, help my unbelief. He had to believe or he would have never brought his son to Jesus to begin with.
He saw the signs and wonders Jesus was doing, so he had to believe Jesus could do it. But the problem was, he still didn't believe, even though he believed. He still had some unbelief. He still had some doubt. He had doubt. Because he asked the if question. The truth is, you can go back to Acts 19 and see this play out as well with the one I started with. If you have doubt in who Jesus is and you claim to be a born-again Christian, then you're inevitably doubting who you are as well. Because you don't know your identity. And by the way, to finish that spout, your identity is found in Christ and Christ alone. Nowhere else. That's where your identity is found. But if you doubt who you are, and if you doubt what God can do, and I'm going to tell you right now, the demons know who Jesus is. James 2:19, you believe there is one God? That's good. The demons believe and tremble. They know what Jesus is capable of. They know what the Father is capable of. They know what the Holy Spirit's capable of. So they want to make sure that you have doubt. Because if you have doubt, you can't operate in the authority and the power that God wants to put upon you to see other people free and to see yourself free. The moment that you stop doubting what God can do in your life is the moment you will see the greatest breakthrough to ever happen in your life. But you have to believe. You have to fully believe. You can't be this double-minded thing of believing here and then being doubtful here. You have to fully believe. If you want the breakthrough, you got to believe. You got to walk in the belief. If you want to see your friends and family delivered, then you got to walk in the belief. And I know that's got to be true because God made this mic work better than it ever has when these mics were going by. Hallelujah. It's louder than it was the whole time. As they come up here and get ready to do the last song, go ahead and hit the next slide, Amber. And I'll probably be here. Pause for 1 second, please. They're getting ready to sing this one last song. And fittingly, it's called Reckless Love. Sorry. Like I said, if it hurts your feelings, I hate to say it, but I'm not sorry. Because the truth is the truth, and the only way we're going to get the truth out is start hurting some feelings. In love. I love you enough to hurt your feelings. I love you enough to offend you. Because I want to see you free. So with that said, if you need prayer, if you need to be freed, just hit the like button, say amen, something on the Facebook post or on the YouTube whenever it comes up, hopefully sometime next week. Let us know. Because we really want to see you free. We really do. And what I preach today may not make us the most popular. It may stop us from going into a few churches. But that's okay. Yep. Right?
The truth will set you free.
Exactly.
Whether you like it or not.
Say that loudly.
The truth will set you free whether we like it or not.
There we go. She's right. So they're going to do this song. I don't know if y'all got anything to add or whatever, but I'm going to hand the mic over to Amber, and whenever y'all are ready to start singing, just let me know. And you guys, if you need prayer, let us know. Listen to the words of this song, because it's pretty powerful in this sense as well. Yeah, if y'all got anything, I'm sure their ears are open.
Just what's been on my mind. Just what's been on my mind is, whoops. I don't know if you can hear me. Nope. We're not here for ourselves.
No.
Yeah, we're here because we love you all. We're not doing this for fun, for our health. You know, I can sing at home. I do in the car. Amber does. I mean, you know, we don't have to be here. We don't have to be singing. We're singing to worship the Lord, to welcome in the Holy Spirit, and we're doing all this for you all. Because we want to see people free. We want to see the power of God spread through this world to defeat the darkness. Wouldn't it be nice if through the Holy Spirit we defeated the darkness, and when Jesus come back, he's like, well done. You all have done a great job. I want to hear that.
Yeah, amen.
Most definitely. Wouldn't that be awesome?
Amen.
He'd come riding in on his horse and be like, y'all have done so good.
Well done, my good and faithful servant.
What I want to hear.
All ready?
Yep.
Still you give your shadow you won't light up, a mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
You, Lord, to prepare us. Prepare us for the battle. Prepare us for the war. As Isaiah said, Lord, send me. And we say the same thing. Send us. Send those that are watching, Lord, that are willing. Send us into the battlefields. Let us war this war. And let us come victoriously through with you, bringing as many with us as we possibly can, because we know that the victory is yours. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.